There we are. Okay, so we are recording. Sorry. So
got
please,
it.
Yeah, thank you so much. It's wonderful. So you got an apartment, a cheap apartment.
I got a cheap apartment. I started to work at the Puppetry Center. This is where Jim Henson has all his stuff stored. This is where, like, it's a museum of puppetry arts. And I started to work painting there. I started to work at a theater called Serenby, which is now defunct because of sexual harassment and abuse of their workers. So glad they're not a theater anymore. I never had any issues with them. It was more upper management, and which I can talk about. Theaters are weird places to work at. there's a lot of politics involved, but yeah, over the next year before the pandemic started, I just started to work at theaters, and my job was word of mouth. I have only once had to give a resume. So to this day, over the 5 years, because I've been here exactly 5 years, I am one of three scenic painters in the city. So between me, Ash, and Teak, we get all the jobs. And this is at theaters. This is at entertainment venues. I'm the charge at the Atlanta Aquarium. I'm the charge at Stone Mountain Park, which I don't know if you've ever heard of, but it's like, it has a Confederate monument on it, which is awkward and bad. But the park itself is like a natural, not theme park. It's weird, but there's like a village that you can walk through and all that. and they pay very well, so I like, and they're very nice, so I work with them. But any other kind of venue that needs a freelance painter, because I'm freelance, I have as many jobs as I want to take at a time, and basically everybody that I work with are people that I know. So I would say 90% of the people I work with are my friends, like people that I've gotten to know. The community is very, very small. Once again, there's only three scenics, so we divide it, and we're all friends. Like, I'm actually seeing Ash tomorrow, and we're gonna do some arts and crafts, and we're gonna go to this collage event at this place called The Bakery, where they just bring people together and you make collages. So yeah, I mean, it's great. I can tell, though, the second thing on the prompt, I can at least say the best or the most difficult part of transitioning from college to real life was scheduling. Because I'm a freelance and I have, let's say, the most theaters I have responsibility for a week are five. I can have five shows in a week. So I can split my day. I can even time it down to the hour, where I'm going to be, how long in traffic it's going to take me to get to each venue, and how long it will take to actually paint the set. Because for the most part, I'm the only one painting a professional level set. I buy the paints, I mix the paints, and I paint it myself. So it's nice. I stay very physically fit, which is good because it's a very physically demanding job, but I paint every day of my life. And I will say that the painting is theatrical. So most of the time I'm painting wood to look like other wood. I'm painting faux treatments. I'm kind of, if something comes my way, I just make it up as I go. Because theater, we don't have any time. Like, I'll have at most 3 weeks to paint a musical such as Oklahoma or Singing in the Rain, you know, some very big professional musical. Sometimes I only have 2 days to paint a set. Like, it's very arbitrary, but what I like about it is that it's based on me. Like, I am my own boss. I have to work with the set designer and the director and the technical director who's in charge of building the set. But in the end, I'm kind of an independent person coming in, getting the job done, and getting the hell out of there when I'm done. So, yeah. but yeah, scheduling, biggest thing I had to learn, because you cannot overbook. You cannot promise yourself to three different people that you can't fulfill, because if you have a reputation to build, you have to build it. You have to make it seem like you're the best ever, and you have to prove that to all of your the people that you work with, because one bad review basically can make you not have work anymore, which is nuts. But it also pays to be extremely friendly and kind and considerate, because I think that's another biggest thing. My personality is innately friendly, but the fact that you want to make friends with your coworkers and you want to still keep a professional distance, which is difficult in the theater world because we're all just a little too close to each other, you know? Like, we have to work very closely in each other's space and we have to know how to communicate with each other. Yeah, that's, but professionality, schedule, but still being friendly. And then another thing that I can tell you was the weird transition from life to, or sorry, school to work. Sometimes I have work for 2 months straight. Other times I have no work for a month. Like, sometimes theaters aren't going on. Like during the summer, there's no productions. During the winter, like Christmas time, there's nothing going on. So I've had to find ways to not be bored, because I think that's what happened during the pandemic. All the theaters shut down. I didn't have work for maybe 4 months straight. I had just bought my house, so I had no money. And I had to not, I became very depressed and very idle hands, you know, do the devil's work. So it was very stressful. And when you're depressed, it's difficult to do work. It's difficult to be inspired as an artist. And actually this painting right here, I painted during the shutdown, and like the shelter in place. I put on Game of Thrones. I binged all of Game of Thrones and I painted that painting, and it was not a good time. So in the meantime, I've learned to find projects and to find, like, we can talk about it later, but I've started to paint clothing and I've started to sell my painted clothing, which is like becoming very successful, surprisingly. And it's something that I have only done during the times that I don't have work. And that's kind of like my rule. When I have work, I don't work on it. When I don't have work, this is what I devote my time and energy to. Because when I paint clothing, I'm just in my house watching TV with my dog next to me. And it's wonderful because then I don't need to leave the house and I can still make art. Because I'm definitely more of a homebody kind of person. Okay, I'm going to move on to another question. You said, what were the things at Virginia Tech that helped you in the transition? At least in the theater. I know, I assume nobody here works in the theater department, but I know working in the theater department, they put us through professional level rigor in terms of, this is how you paint a set. These are the schedules. These are the kind of relationships that you have to have with others. And because for 4 years, I was only one of two students interested in scenic painting, we just painted all the shows. So I think college gave me the ability to actually do the work in a professional sort of environment. And that's the only way that I learned how to easily transition into the real world, because I was already doing it and I already knew how to handle the stress and the load and the responsibilities. So I recommend, yeah, getting internships, doing actual professional work in school while you can, and it'll make the transition so much easier to get in and just be like, oh, I already know how to do this. And I actually thought school is more stressful. I think professionally, theater-wise, there are a lot less rules. There's a lot less safety requirements, if I could say, in the real world than in school. So it was like good to go through like boot camp in college and then transition. What I learned from the art side of like going through SOVA was critiques. I think critiques were the thing that I love the most and that has helped me into this real world, because in the real world, people don't care about you as much and how personally you take criticism, because my job requires me to please the designer. I have to please the designer, but at the same time, I can be confident in my work enough to be like, hey, I think this choice should be made. Can I do it this way? And I can convince them that their way is wrong, and then I can do it my way because I know how to do this. And there's ways I can negotiate my voice and my mark making and my vision into the design while still collaborating with the designer. But also sometimes the designer is strict and needs everything the way they want it. And I think having a thick skin and being able to take criticisms from professors is a very good thing, because people in the real world are going to be so much harsher, so much just not crueler, but just more honest, that knowing how to take it elegantly and actually work with it is the best possible thing. Because I think if I hadn't had that practice, I would have cried a bunch at critiques that I would have gotten at work. And it's work. It's a professional environment. So you have to, you just have to take it and move on. So
that's great.
Thank you for, thank you for giving me that.
I know you're pointing at Travis. You know, that's really good to share.
No, Travis was always so nice. So
Well, I'll get to your question in a minute, Deanna, but that's really nice because we had the only other alumni that we've had so far, we have some more coming up, was a CT alumni, Creative Technologies alumni. And he's now working for a company that makes assets for games. So very different from your experience. Yeah. But the thing you have in common is he also said that critiques were really helpful for him because he gets like he makes a game set and then the people are managing him, his bosses will say, no, this is wrong, you know, and have him redo it. And he's just like, oh my God, I just spent a month on this, you know, cause he has a different schedule. And it was, and because he had those critiques here, he really was able to handle that. So I think that's wonderful that even though you two have very different worlds that you have that in common. So anyways, and then Deanna says, might be a weird question, but I've been kind of worried about, this is in the chat, making my passion my job, because I feel like I'm, make me enjoy it as much. Do you get to do a lot of your own projects? How fulfilling is painting the sets? Like I'm thinking about how I personally have way too many personal projects going at one time. I guess I'm wondering if you treat your set painting as if it's just 9 to 5 that pays the bill, or are you like, I love this?
So yes, I can answer that. No, I understand your questions. So I love that scenic painting has become a job. It is a job. It just happens to be one that I get to paint stuff. So I think in that way, like my personal artwork and my professional artwork, they are separate. Professionally, I am following orders. I am a cog in the machine. And I love that I've become so good at the technique. Just like with Bob Ross, you know how to paint the picture using technique and pieces. There's really no creativity to it, and not as much. It's more of following a formula. And I like that because I'm already good enough with art, I'm already practiced enough that it pays my bills. And at the end of the day, great. I don't necessarily want to do this forever, and I don't love theater enough to like consider it my passion. It pays my bills. So I'm just very fortunate that number one, I have so much freedom and I have so much independence and I get to paint. Personal artwork, that's me. Those are my ideas. I don't have anybody else telling me what to do. I get to paint what I want to paint in oils on my own time. And when I feel the inspiration, it helps though that I'm painting all the day, every day, all the time. So I'm always in practice. Like I'm never getting out of a creative mode. I paint during the day, I come home and I paint or draw something in the afternoon or with my clothing, or I'll sew because I sew clothing as well. So I always have to be doing something, but I like that my personal art is fun and work is work. So that's how I'm separating the two. But yeah, I only get to do my own projects when I have time though, because in the end I have to devote all of my energy and attention to making art at work. But sometimes like work is fun. Like work is still fun. I really love how weird my job is, how many strange little things I get to do. Like one of my paintings that I had to do was a portrait of a man and a woman naked, lounging in front of a fireplace. Like, you know, that's awesome. Like, I love when the weird stuff comes up and you just kind of look forward to that. And, I don't know. This job isn't stressful either. And I'm very fortunate to have chosen a job that isn't like, it's fun. I mean, it can be overwhelming and people can be evil sometimes and frustrating, but yeah. Oh, what was that? I'm thinking about personally way too much personal projects. Once you get out into the real world, you just have to make time for those personal projects. But in the end, what pays your bills and pays your taxes, because that's another thing I have to talk about. I'm a freelance, so none of my taxes are taken out. So I'm very afraid about this next cycle, I'm going to be having to owe a lot of money. So that's another part of my job that kind of is difficult and that I have to focus all my energies in are being financially stable to own a house, to own my car, to be able to pay my taxes, because independent contracting, you get paid a lot initially, but then the government will come in and take the rest. So I hope that kind of answered your question.
Definitely.
Yeah.
So for the freelancing, Stefnie, do you, I think that's a good point to kind of talk about is like, it's different than having an employer that's sort of like is paying into Social Security and covering insurance and, you know, setting aside stuff for taxes. And so that's, you know, there's a different kind of planning and sort of setting aside. And I remember you as a very organized person anyway, so I'm not surprised to hear you saying that like, your job is not stressful, even though it sounds very stressful to me, like juggling five different operations and going between these things. But I think probably part of it not being stressful is having a good sort of like organizational sense, which, like I said, I remember that being sort of your deal. So that's a question. Maybe talk a little bit about the organizational part of it and how hard it was to kind of learn that. And then if you could also talk about like, do you work with other people? I mean, you said you're the only person that usually paints, but are there other people that sort of help you do things like when you're in different theaters that you have to kind of like supervise in different ways?
Sure. I can talk all about that. Okay. First thing, organization. This is my schedule book. I don't know if you can see it, but I do it in pencil because my job, to add more stress to you, Travis, every day I don't know what I'm doing. Like, I'll have a general plan, but working in theater, if the set isn't built, I can't paint it. Or I could be texted the night before saying, hey, can you come in today? And I have to do it. So my life has been organizing in a schedule book because overbooking is very bad. But I've had to learn that the best way to organize and manage all of this is just to write it down and to like, I don't know, and you get used to it. Like, I can't give you a definite answer on how I was able to do it, but you just have to keep knowing. I think the best part of it is that I know how long it's going to take me to paint something. Having an idea of how long it's going to take you to do the thing and then being able to plan out ahead of time. And then if you get it done early, you have free time and you can go paint somewhere else, which is really great. And every other way, organizing money, everything goes into savings, you know, like it's been that kind of thing where I pay for what I need. The rest of it goes into savings. Like actually, Friday, my house is from the 70s and the windows are horrible. I've saved up for the past year to replace all the windows and they're finally installing them on Friday. So yeah, it's been a weird, and we've redone the kitchen. My mom does home construction. So we've redone the kitchen. We've redone the bathroom. And those are actually projects I do when I don't have work and that I've saved up money. But also I never know how much money I'm going to make each year. I don't know. I have no plan. I have no, because just like yesterday, I got a text from the aquarium saying, hey, can you come in for a day next week? And cool, I'm probably going to make $400 just randomly. At Stone Mountain Park, I do a one-sum fee. I'll plan out a schedule. They'll pay me $7,000 to design and paint a set. And cool, got $7,000 I didn't know I was going to have before. So yeah, there's a lot of financial insecurity in this job, and somehow you just make it work, I guess. You just have to do it. You just have to not spend any money any time. But also, I'm covered. I have 23 tattoos now, so I just spend the money on tattoos. Regarding working with people, so how it works is my immediate supervisor is called the technical director, and they are in charge of building the set. My immediate boss is actually the production manager who writes all my checks and kind of organizes and coordinates the schedule. My coworker is the designer. And usually they don't have any involvement in the building of the set, only in giving me renderings, drawings, all that. And we usually have a close communication. There are some designers in this town I don't like, and I actually have a mediator to work around. So, you know, relationships are weird and communication is weird, but really when I come into a job site, the technical director has carpenters, and as carpenters finish stuff, I come in and paint them. And we're usually in a shop. Every place that I work at is in an industrial shop that has tools and concrete floors, and it's very informal and creepy parts of town, you know, like, but every step of the process, the technical director is the person I'm always in contact with, because the only way that I can get stuff done is if they have it built, and then I get to paint it afterwards. We call it load in. Is when they have all the stuff built in the shop, loaded into the theater itself. Then I'll come in, do touch-ups, because carpenters are sloppy and horrible, and they ruin everything that I paint. So I have to come in then afterwards and fix everything that they've ruined. And then theater is also very fluid in that the director will come in and add stuff or strike stuff. So I never, ever know anything about anything, and you just have to play in the moment, and it helps so much that your TD and your carpenters are good people, because that's the only way we get stuff done, is communication. And otherwise, I love that I'm the only one painting, because I do not work very well with others in terms of painting itself. It's actually rare that my friend Ash, who's also a painter, we work very well together. That's rare. Because yeah, I'm very independent. I like getting stuff done the way I want it. So I like that this job affords me the capacity to be the only one who touches the paint and who works with the paint. And they trust me enough, being like, Stefnie will make it amazing. So I'm like, yes, I will. Just trust me, leave me alone. and then I leave. I never see the productions. I have no interest. Once I'm done with the show, I move on to another thing, because I'm just so busy. Though my mother and my grandmother just recently moved to Atlanta, and so they've now required me to get tickets to every show, so they see the shows. They love the work. I will let them be their own thing. But yeah, theater, you have to work with people all the time, and you have to communicate, and you have to do what people say and and get it done. And then you're good. And then you leave. So yeah, it's a lot to organize, but I guess you just get used to it. It just becomes the fabric of your existence with time, because it's been 5 years now of doing this, that it's very easy. So even if it kind of seems difficult at first, you just got to do it, I guess.
Yeah, that makes sense. I mean, you sort of like get better at your craft and your technique over time, as well as organizing the jobs and knowing the expectations. I wonder, you know, as someone who has sort of like high expectations for a finished product in your own work, like, how do you find, have you had to struggle to find a balance for like what's good enough and what? Well,
yeah, that's exactly it. So theater done is better than good. And and that sometimes rips away your soul. I've had to sacrifice parts of my soul because I have very little time to complete something. And as a scenic artist, you learn to get it done so that it looks good enough. And some places I can make things look better. Some things I can, you know, finesse. But quick and dirty is the way to go. The benefit is that most of the time people are seeing it from 30 feet away anyway. So I work in an environment where so the carpenters build the sets actor safe. They're not beautiful. They're actor safe. I come in and I make them beautiful. I make them look good under lights, because I'm also working with a lighting designer to pick out colors and to make sure that the overall aura of the space fits the themes and the story. But yeah, Travis, theater is not precise. Theater is messy. My clothes are usually covered in paint. I have to get stuff done. And most of the time, that's good enough. That's why when I come home and I do my art, I can pay attention to it. I can put my level of attention to detail. I can supplement all of the anxiety and the anal kind of perfectionism here. Because at work, if I was that way, I would never get any work. I would never get anything done. So Yeah, you just have to sacrifice part of your soul as an artist, as a scenic artist, just to get paid. So that's the reality of it. So,
nice. Did you want to answer any of the other questions? I mean, so you sort of have, but anything else you wanted to add from the question?
Yeah, I think, oh, another tip that I want to recommend if any of you artists are going to be freelance, know your worth. Because in the beginning of this job, I was paid dirt and I allowed it. I accepted it. I didn't know how much my work was worth. I didn't know any artists, so I didn't know how much to get paid per hour. The least I've ever gotten paid at the crappiest theater that I've ever worked for was $14, or no, it was $13 an hour. And my boss felt so bad that he's like, oh, I'll bump you up an hour just to be nice. And I'm like, so with time, there's a confidence level that you have to put forth towards a business when you're asking for a contract or you're asking for money. If you confidently say, I'm worth $50 an hour, most of the time they will give you that money. You know, like it's how you give yourself and how you sell yourself and how your reputation can speak for how much you can get paid. And that's why some theaters I can't work for anymore because they can't afford me. So like coming into the business, yes, it's fine if you get the shitty jobs, if you get paid a little less, you're getting the experience, but you're growing your reputation. Once you have your reputation, put your foot down and get paid what you need to survive. Do never compromise on anything less than your worth, even if it takes you a little time to know that. As far as like a full-time job, I don't know how much I'm worth if I was at a full-time job. I mean, anything more than 40 grand a year sounds amazing. So like if a full-time job were to even offer me that, I'd be like, yes, please, stability. But in the meantime, I make it clear to everybody that I work for, the lowest I get paid is $25 an hour. The highest I've gotten paid is like tattoo rates, and that's $150 an hour. And, or film rates, I don't really work for film anymore because they treat you badly. They pay you a lot of money, but I don't have any artistic creative like freedoms. I'm just another worker ant. And even though you're working on really cool projects, I've stopped working for film. Plus you have to join a union and I don't really want to join the film union because I could go on a long story why, but yeah. Know your worth. And coming out of college, you're worth more than you think. I know. I saw there was another question too. How many extra sets of clothing do you need just for painting? So half of my closet is devoted to painting clothes. And it's funny that I have to go to Aldi or grocery shopping after work and I have to be in my paint clothes. And sometimes I get work by being in my paint clothes because somebody will come up to be like, hey, do you paint? I'm like, yeah, I do. Hire me here. So like for murals or other things like that, I'm self-advertising, but what I learned is that wear clothes that are comfortable. Like if you're working in a very physically intensive environment for 8 to 12 hours a day, make sure your paint clothes are the most comfortable clothes that ever existed. Who cares how they look? They're going to get covered in paint anyway. But half of my existence is in stretchy pants, as long as they have pockets, because I can put my phone in, because every rendering that I paint from is from my phone. I never print stuff out. I don't like having a tangible copy. I really like working from my phone. And even if there's color distortion, I've done this long enough to kind of compensate visually for any color distortions that might be in the rendering, because I know lighting and stuff. But yeah, half of my closet is full. And what I do is Goodwill here in Georgia has 99-cent Mondays. So basically, every half year, I throw away all my clothes and I just get new ones because I can get 15 pieces for 15 bucks. And it costs me very little to always be comfortable and always have new clothes. Though a good pair of boots is always very helpful too, because my boots are like an inch thick covered in paint. So comfortable shoes, that's also very important. Yeah. Curious about film, and I keep that in mind. Yeah, film, it depends. Film, I have opinions about film because you just have to experience it to know. some people maybe have really good experiences in film, working at least on more of the technical side. For me, being a scenic painter, all of the film studios just, I don't know, it's basic work and you get paid stupid amounts of money to just paint walls. And again, that part of my soul that devotes myself to art, I don't like it. I don't, even though there's the possibility of making more money, the sacrifices that I have to make creatively, I don't, it's not worth it. Because in order to do like high level film artwork, you have to be in the business. You have to suffer for like 10 years before you can actually do good, big things. So as long as you're willing to go into that risk and take the risk and meet people who maybe aren't the nicest or the safest people, because I feel like the film world is maybe a little more toxic than theater. Though, like I mentioned in the beginning, there are still some theaters that have very toxic managing styles, and thank goodness they close. But that's also with any business too. Can you please tell us more about your paint clothes? I wish I could take you guys upstairs to my closet to see. Another thing about scenic painting is that most of the shops that I work in don't have heat. So so when I work somewhere, I have to layer up like 10 layers and eventually peel them off as the day goes on, because the environments that I work in are sometimes outside. Like working at Stone Mountain Park, it's all outside. So I have to paint with the weather in consideration. I can't paint when it rains. Do you mean paint clothes? Oh, I can talk about the paint and clothes business. Yeah. Cool. So yes, sorry. So last year, I started to paint jumpsuits because I have some painting jumpsuits, and I was getting a lot of attention from people saying, "Hey, this is really cool. Do you sell these?" And I'm like, "No, I don't. These are mine." So I didn't have work for about a month. During that time, I'm like, you know what? I'm going to start painting clothing just for fun. And so I've always been interested in Japanese imagery, 19th century Japanese imagery. I've always been interested in 1960s, like pulp imagery. How can I make that into Stefnie? You know, how can I draw inspiration from these two worlds and turn them into something that is me? And so I started painting like Levi Strauss jackets. I started painting jumpsuits and like name brand stuff that I could find once again at Goodwill for cheap. And I started selling it to my friends and they wanted more. And then my friend Ash, who is this other scenic painter, she's very entrepreneurial and is very good at bringing together people. So we are now business partners and we do a pop-up market. And this has just been something we've organized the past 2 months. But she's become my business partner in, we're called the Highfalutin Hags, which is great. We wanted a very edgy name.
That's great.
But yeah, so we found out that people are, at least I'm 27, people a little younger than me and people a little older than me really like the art that we make, especially around Atlanta. People who aren't in the art scene like our stuff. They want to wear our stuff. They want to be cool because Atlanta has this hipster culture that's awesome and beautiful and interesting. And so we did an initial pop-up at my friend's house and it was very successful. So over the course of the past 2 months, we've been she has a lot of friends, art friends. I have no art friends. So she's basically asking all her friends to bring their art into one space, and we're actually selling them at breweries. We email breweries saying, "Hey, we're a local pop-up. We just started. Is that okay if we sell art at your exhibits, or sorry, at your places?" And we've had 5 breweries so far be like, "Yes, we want artists to come in. We want a different clientele. We want more business." So again, I have like a stock of clothing that I paint different images on, and different sizes and shapes, and I use acrylic paint so that it's washable. So all of the clothing I make is functional. I'm also selling it at a store too. So when we were looking for spaces to do our pop-up, a store had come up and I just cold emailed them saying, "Hey, I have clothing. Would I be able to sell it with you?" And they said, "Yes, immediately. We love your stuff. Just sell it." So everything regarding this clothing has just been like, it just works. You know, you put out an email and people are like, "Yeah, we want this." And then you just have to start making clothing. You have to kind of start a business plan. You have to start organizing email addresses, Instagram pages, coordinating people. And I'm very good at that side of things. Ash, my friend, is good at getting the people together. I'm good, like you said, Travis, I'm very good at organizing. So the money, the emails, the conversations. And it's just to get art out. Like, this is an extra source of income for me, which is really great because over like a month, I made maybe $600 off of, and it's cash, which is really nice too. $600 off of a few pieces. Like, it's, and it's unexpected and interesting. And so yeah, we're having our pop-up. Our first official pop-up is actually on Saturday at a brewery. We have 8 artists total. And I have 40 pieces. They all have, like, I think over in total, we have like 200 pieces ranging from painted clothing, prints, you know, stuff people can buy easily and can just have. My grandmother knits. So I have a bunch of knitted clothing by my grandmother that I'm selling. But yeah, we hope that it grows bigger and we can get more people, more artists involved. And it's just because we sometimes don't have work. This is what we're doing on the side, just for fun, basically. And it's working out really, really cool. Also, if we were to do share screen, I can show you guys some of the work.
Yeah, you're it's enabled. Yeah, please. Okay. That'd be great.
Okay, let's see.
Elaine said, that's so cool. And so does Deanna. That's so cool. Yay. I agree. I love the highfalutin hags. That's rad.
Thank you. Yeah, it's become a really cool, okay, hold on. I have to see how I can share.
You roll over the bottom, you see the green button?
Yep, and my computer, let's see, open, allow Zoom to share your screen. I want to do that. I'm sorry, this is...
It's okay.
Privacy, okay, it is not allowing me to, that's not good.
Hmm.
Screen sharing and recording. Okay. Without wasting too much of our time.
You have a website or something?
I do. Yeah. If one of you can pull up the website, I would say the website is quite outdated. So we will not see, like, the best place to see my work is actually Instagram. So if you were to even pull up my Instagram, we could look at that.
Yeah, let's do that. So what's your handle?
My name, Stefnie Cerny, Cerny. And I will say that have a website coming out of college, or even have a website in college and start building it up as you're getting out into the professional world. But people actually look at my Instagram more than my website. I get more business. Yeah, there's our poster. I painted that for our event this Saturday. If you could close that out and go down... I do cartoons too. So there's one of my cartoons. If you go up, let's say it's the fourth image. Yep. Mm-hmm. The one with the ties. If you could click that one.
Sure.
So this is where I sell my clothing. And you can see some examples of my clothing if you go, if you swipe through the
wonderful images.
But as you can see, it's just weird imagery. Like with it, I'm kind of developing my style to be, again, Japanese inspired, just American culture inspired, more cinematic kind of feeling, comic booky. And it's just cool to have it at a store. I mean, like, yeah. And people buy it, which is amazing.
What kind of store?
It's just a gallery space, and it's on the Beltline, which, if you're not from Atlanta, it's this walking path that cuts through the city, and it's very hip. Street, there's a bunch of stores and restaurants, and everybody who's anybody goes on the Beltline. It's just a public walking space. So people on the Beltline can come into this store, which is really cool. If you exit out of here, you can scroll down. So my most recent project at Stone Mountain, scroll down a little bit, scroll to the one that looks like it's nebulous. Up a little bit, go back up. I love that we're doing this.
This one?
Yes, click on that one.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a project that I designed myself. So I designed everything, every wall I pre-planned and mapped out, and I painted I had an assistant. In some situations where I'm paid enough money, I can pay an assistant. And this assistant was actually my best friend. So it just meant that I could hang out with my best friend for 3 weeks straight. But this is actually glow paint, UV paint. So most of the projects that I do at Stone Mountain are UV paint, and those walls are 12-foot tall. So everything you're seeing here is double human, like two humans stacked on top of each other, and it's all glow painted. And I did it in a shop first. And what we did is we used a landscaping tarp, primed it, sealed it, and then painted glow paint on top of the landscaping tarp. And then later they stapled the tarp to flats, like wooden flats. So nice. The theme of this one is that their main character for their like winter festival is an Aurora Borealis princess. So I was painting like these landscapes that she lived in, these ice palaces. And glow paint is very particular. It's a type of paint that you can only work with, it's a different color without the black light than it is with the black light. So that was a really fun project and took me about 20 days to complete. So nice. So that's beautiful. One of my favorite projects I've done recently.
That's
and
great.
What's cool too is that they take it down and then they recycle it next year.
Mm-hmm.
I don't get paid for them to use it again, but whatever.
Yeah, this is wonderful.
Yeah. If you exit out, mm-hmm. I can maybe show you guys one more thing.
Sure.
So I would say down and over to the left, you mm-hmm. can see a set that I've, go back up.
Mm-hmm.
So it's next to the squid. So you see the squid, go to the left of the squid.
This here?
Yep.
This one?
Yep. So that's a set I painted in 8 hours.
Mm, wow.
Yep. So that was Into the Woods and it was at a high school. Oh, that's another thing. I work with high schoolers. So I teach, actually. I work at 4 private schools, and they are rich enough to afford a scenic painter to come in and paint their sets. And sometimes I get to work with students, and I get to teach students how to paint, which is really cool. This one, I was actually really sick when I was painting this, and I just had 8 hours, and I just got it done. And there was no design, and I did this all by myself on the spot. I didn't plan it. I just was there and I'm like, okay, I'm gonna do this. A sponge roller is the greatest invention ever, and I did this whole set with a sponge roller.
Wow. Love your list here.
And then I did yeah, exactly, that's what I felt. I also teach at colleges too. So at Georgia State, they have a theater major, and actually next week I'm going to start teaching a scenic painting class through Georgia State.
That's great.
I only get these college teaching jobs and these high school teaching jobs because people know me, you know, or they know people who know people who are like, oh, you know, scenic artist. Okay, go hire her. She's good. She can teach. I don't love teaching, but I do love people. So I think more than anything, I love talking with the students. And yeah, those are some of the clothing items too. Nice. With my onis, because I love Japanese onis. So I kind of interpret them in my own little way. There's my wolf on one of my jackets. Yeah. So, oh, the frogs too. People love.
I love the frog.
Tiger. Oh, I paint ties, silk ties. So I go to vintage markets and I find silk ties and I paint those. Yeah, it's cool and fun. And no matter what, at the end of the day, hopefully you're going to be doing something that makes you happy and is fun, because I'm very, 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 very lucky that this job is, it makes me happy, I guess. And that's a lot to say.
Yeah, it really is.
I feel good, and I feel tired. That was the poster that Ash had made for our first art pop-up. And also all of the people who I work with are so supportive, so wonderful, so unique in the theater industry that we all really like each other. So I don't know what industries everyone else is going to get in. And if people hate each other or people are competitive, at least in this business, there's no competition because we all just need to get it done and move on. So,
you know, that that makes me think of, do you mind if I ask another question?
Please.
Yeah. I mean, I know stop sharing for a minute, but like Maya's from New Jersey outside of New York City. And so she's has, you know, she'll probably go back to New York for her after college. But so I'm curious, so you chose Atlanta because you heard that there was a lot of opportunity for cinema or yes. film, right? But there were probably a few other places that you thought about. So do you want to talk about that decision?
Sure. Just like going to Virginia Tech, it was the only option that I wanted, and I didn't really go anywhere else or do anything else. It was the same with Atlanta. I never, once people told me, or once I was actually, what do theaters do with the set after the show's done? They throw it away. Everything that I do is thrown away. So it will be up for, So every single piece of artwork that you see on that page that is theater related is thrown in the trash.
That's
or recycled in some way, and I paint it over later. So I am not connected at all to any of my art that I do for theater. I'm connected to this stuff. This stuff is important. Theater stuff, you have no personal attachment whatsoever because it's all just thrown away. So, but yeah, back to Atlanta. Atlanta was the only option. Like it just felt right. I didn't want to move anywhere else. Everything in my life regarding moving and career stuff has just kind of happened. It's been very lucky. It's been very free flowing. And once I do it, it feels right. I just go for it. The reason I moved to Atlanta too was an alum of Virginia Tech of the theater department. He's an art director for film. He art directed Stranger Things and Watchmen and Halt and Catch Fire. Like, he does a lot of shows. He's actually a good friend of a professor that was the theater professor. He actually invited me to stay with him and his wife for a couple days to show me around Atlanta. I'm like, yeah, I want to move here. This is great. This feels good. That's it. So I think that element of just doing it and making it work as you go has kind of worked really well. Also, Atlanta is affordable. It is a very, very affordable city. Again, I own my house. So the fact that I was able to find it and I can afford living here, and I would say everyone else who's in the theater world has an apartment and a roommate. So you can afford something with a roommate. That was another attractive quality. Also, I'm originally from Michigan and I hate the cold. So it was nice to move somewhere that was warm because I hate snow. And snow's pretty. I hate the cold and I don't like winter very much. So that was another kind of selling point.
Michigan's
is that
pretty
Atlanta
rough.
Is very, yeah. And it's just a friendly city. It's just so pretty and friendly, and it's all full of woods, and it's just... but in any other way, that's why I'm here. Just
I think
because.
It's such a great thing to hear because, you know, I know all of you, my students are wondering. They're mostly juniors. Amy's a first semester senior, you know, what comes next? And I think choosing a city, like I moved to New York City when I graduated from college, and it was it was cheaper than many years ago, but. You know, a lot of students are, you know, do we go to New York? Do you go to LA? Do you go to Philadelphia? But I like that you chose, I mean, Atlanta's been up and coming. So you chose kind of a more up and coming city. Is there anything else you wanted to say about that?
No, I mean, Atlanta, I would say is, the most popular up and coming city right now, if I had to say, in terms of the art world. And it's so... on one hand, the city is huge and there's so many opportunities. On the other hand, I went on a date with a guy who knew 10 other people that I knew, and he's not even in the same field. So it's like everybody knows each other in this town, and the community is so small and warm and diverse. Oh my gosh, the amount of people, the diversity, the cultures that are involved, the theaters that I work for that are invested in international acceptance and having voices, especially female voices. I would say being a female artist in Atlanta has been amazing because I am respected. I am respected for what I do. I think that's why my reputation has grown so high, because the people that I work with are they respect me for my work and for and they enjoy who I am too, but I feel like theater is innately an accepting and inclusive place for, you know, gay and trans and any sort of inclination, that it is a beautiful environment in itself to be a woman in this field. I don't have as much experience in the fine art side of things, but because I haven't done gallery work. I haven't worked with fine artists at all. Like, this pop-up is my first actual interaction with artists that aren't theater related. So I can't speak to that. But so far, Atlanta has been very supportive as a woman too. And as a young person, because I started working here when I was 22. So, and I was already immediately welcomed. And that was another beautiful aspect that I don't know about other cities. I don't know how it works in other cities.
Yeah, that's wonderful. I want to open up because you're such a wonderful, engaging person.
Thank you.
We're running out of time, but
yeah.
Does anybody who hasn't asked a question want to ask one? Amy, Berkeley, Anna, Maya.
Come on, at least one question.
I know you have some in there. I know Berkeley's a little sick, but one of you can muster a question, I think.
I'm trying to think if there was anything else in my notes.
But anybody that has asked a question, Elaine or Deanna, do either of you have more questions? Would it be all right if some students who are interested in this kind of world reach out to you?
Of course. Oh my gosh, yes. I've actually had a couple theater students that have graduated after me reach out before. So I love when I can give any sort of advice or any inspiration. I'm here for you.
Yeah. That's fantastic. Yeah, I really admire how quickly you've managed to make things work for yourself. It's really impressive.
Thank you very much. Yeah, it's all been alone too, because my mother was always my go-to right-hand person in anything that I did during college. We lived together. We have a very close relationship. She was living in Alabama for the past 5 years. And so it was me with no family. I had to make all my connections myself. I had everything that I have now is because I did it myself. So have the confidence to do that and the courage, and it will work. Like, you will mess up. The pandemic will happen. You'll lose a bunch of money, but making solid friends, making solid connections has so far been very positive to me, at least in this experience. And now that my mom lives nearby, I can now reap the benefits of having her, which is really great, because now she can babysit my dog, and which is great. But yeah, it's,
that's fantastic.
I would say it's a lot of luck too. I've been very lucky. So it's a mixture of a lot of things, maybe.
Yeah. You know, it sounds to me like you made a lot of choices that were instinctual.
Yes.
You know, and correct. Some people think of instinct as like not thinking, but I think of instinct as like a combination of like intuition, which is kind of coming from like feeling, but it comes from many, many decisions we've made in the past, right? Yeah. It's not a non-thinking thing. And yeah. So I try to tell my students to pay attention to their intuition, because it comes from all, it's like a cognitive net and a somatic, also a bodily net. And so it sounds like you're good at listening to that. So
I think that's how every decision I've made has gone. So yeah, so far it's worked, because if it feels right, then you should do it. And if it doesn't feel right, you need to stop doing it. Just like if you ever work at an environment that makes you feel unsafe or uncomfortable or doesn't pay you enough, you need to leave it.
Trust yourself. Like,
yes, because you're more important than them. So
that's so good. How about anyone else? Travis or anyone else?
I was just going to say that idea about luck, like, I feel that way too. I feel very fortunate to kind of be in the position that I'm in my life. But I also feel like for you, you know, and for a lot of people that make their way through the world, there's rarely a really straight, predictable path in the arts. And everybody kind of has to find, everybody that I know has a very, you know, unique idiosyncratic story. You kind of have to put your way in the, and you have to put yourself in the way of luck. And I feel like, you know, making decisions and You can't really sit at home and be lucky. You kind of have to work to be lucky. And it sounds like you've done that. So yeah, it's really great seeing you, Stefnie. And so glad to hear about what you've been up to. And it just, everything looks really great. Love the cartoons on Instagram too. Those are funny. Yeah.
Those, I only do those when when something really funny happens at work or with my dog. That's my that's like my fun work, you know, just quick. I can do it. All my cartoons are within 2 hours and they're like a prompt and they kind of let me do something creative for 2 hours and then I'm done and then it's good. So yeah, I appreciate you following and checking in and it's wonderful. Oh,
thank you.
I have one question. What was moving out like when you had a strong relationship with your mom? Did you move out? Yes. So I immediately, I moved. So part one of the question, my mother, got divorced when I was 12. So, it was just her and I living together for 9 years and she's a very strong, independent woman. And she raised me to be very strong and independent and not to rely on anyone. So moving out from her was very easy, even though we had such a strong connection. I already had the basis of independence and kind of initiative that it was not difficult to kind of go out on my own after school, while still keeping her very close in my life. And I did move out immediately after graduation. Actually, my mom and I moved at the same time. She moved down to Alabama and she basically dropped me off in Atlanta on the way down with all my stuff and was like, bye. What is it like going from college to work? Like easy. I can I say I hated college? I hate school. Like college was great, but I like life better than college. So college to me was a prison sentence that I just had to complete. And I'm glad I learned everything. And I loved all the people that I worked with, but transitioning into life was so much easier that once I actually started my life, I'm like, finally, you know, I can actually have my own rules. I don't have any grades. I can make money. I can get tattoos with my own money, you know. So it was very easy for me to transition.
Yeah. No, thank you so much. I know you have a tight schedule, so we'll let you go. But is there anything else you want to say?
No, you guys have been great. And Ask me to do this again.
You know, I think we should do more with our alumni. So I'm going to try to, we just got an alumni coordinator for the college overall. Okay. And so, you know, I'm going to tell her about you if that's okay.
Sure.
And, you know, cause I think that alumni is just, it's so important. So I'm really, really happy you came. And, does anybody else want to say anything?
Thank you, everyone.
Why don't we unmute ourselves and I'll say thank you.
Yeah.
So Stefnie for coming.
Thank
you. Can you unmute yourselves?
Thank you.
And I hope you guys have a good rest of your semester.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Yay, everybody.
Okay. I'll get going now. Goodbye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.